Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Rashed Daher, and I'm very pleased. I have the pleasure to have this lecture here today among you. I'm an assistant professor at Eötvös Loránd University in Budapest in the Department of Arabic and Semitic Studies. Apart from that, I have the honor, I got the honor, to be the director of a relatively newly established center at the university, at ELTA, Faculty of Humanities, which is the Contemporary Arab World Center. My basic research field is the conflict going on in Northern Africa. Namely, I call it the GERD conflict, the Great Ethiopian Renaissance Dam conflict, which emerged around 10 years ago and somehow was left forgotten until the last couple of years, where suddenly the international media, the Arab media, and I think the public in general started to deal with this issue seriously. As an introduction, I had my first experience with this topic back to 2017, when I was spending a three-week scholarship in Cairo. By that time, this problem was swept under the carpet, as they used to say. And in fact, in Egypt, very few people dared to talk about it. I had a couple of lectures at the Cairo University, and by chance, I met one of my colleagues at the Department of Arabic Studies. I went for dinner with him, and we were having a good conversation, a nice talk. And he started to talk to me about the future problems of Egypt. So I listened carefully. He told me that his wife really conducted a very big study about an issue called the Nile issue. Because, of course, he exaggerated a lot. He said that everybody will die from thirst here, there will be no water in Egypt. So I got interested in the topic. And the next day, I was invited to his home, where I met his wife, who is a really water expert, and she really told me about her study, which was not published, in fact, for security reasons, and because this case shouldn't get a public attention before its time. This is what she told me. Anyway, from that time on, I came back to Budapest, and I started to dig a little bit deeper. And whenever I did that, I found a very interesting topic. Everybody here, for example, in Europe, was busy with the migration waves coming from Iraq, Syria, and other districts of Asia and Africa. But in fact, what made me a little bit frustrated and a little bit astonished is that nobody really was dealing with this Nile problem as a future migration problem. So this was the very beginning of my interest in this topic. From that time on, I started working on my research to figure out and to understand what's going on in the basin of the Nile. So this is why I started writing articles about this. I participated in a couple of conferences in the United States and elsewhere with this topic, and I found really interesting results. Now, to go back to the subject, I would like to go back in time to 2011. Let's take this year as a starting point for our talk today. As a technical issue, I would like to announce first that at the end of the lecture of my monologue, there will be a session for QA, so you can ask questions. And one more thing, is that I don't want to bother everyone with very, very details. So I'll keep the details for the questions if someone is interested in the details, especially in geometric and engineering details related to the dam. So I have one of my colleagues who maybe he will ask, but I hope not. So, okay. Anyway, so this project of the Nile, I call it the GERD project, started in 2011. But the roots of the problem goes back very much in time to the 1960s, where the U.S. Bureau for Reclamation, UBSR, USBR, conducted a study for Ethiopia, how can it utilize the Nile to achieve social and economic development. And in 1964, they put on the table a study of building a dam on the same exact place where this current dam stands, but with a little bit smaller dam and with a smaller basin, so a smaller lake behind the dam. So a reservoir of 14 billion cubic meters was suggested, which is compared to the current reservoir behind the dam, 74 billion cubic meters. It was a really much smaller dam. But the project was forgotten soon, because when we are talking about the 1960s and 70s and even 80s, so Egypt was a really strong regional power by that time, and Ethiopia was suffering from poverty and illiteration and a lot of things. So it wasn't the time for Ethiopia to show up with such a project. That's why this project was forgotten for about 40 years, 30 years. Up until 1991, when Meles Zenawi, the former prime minister of Ethiopia, who just passed away in 2013, he said that this is not a situation we can go along with. Ethiopia needs development, Ethiopia needs food security, Ethiopia needs a lot of things. And we have one of the best resources in the world. We have the longest river in the world, which the main tributary of this river emerges from Lake Tana, which is in Ethiopia, and we are not utilizing this river. So started to lay down the basis for a mega project of building a huge dam on, depending on, of course, the studies conducted by the USBR. Well, by that time, the Hosni Mubarak Egypt was still a strong regional power, and Meles Zenawi's dreams were also forced to be forgotten again, and Ethiopia, in fact, didn't do anything for further 20 years. Not until 2010. We have to remember what happened in 2010. 2010, there was a big food shortage in the world. The prices were very high, and Egypt had to import wheat and had to import essential food supplies, which raised the price of the crops in the rural parts of the country. This was one of the factors that led to the 2011 revolution in the country. In that same year, there was an agreement between the framework, let's call it the Nile Basin framework, in Antepe, between the countries, the upstream countries of the Nile, and Egypt and Sudan didn't take part in it. So in 2010, everything started over. So everything looked like Ethiopia is really willing to implement something in the future. And here we have reached the crucial year, 2011, where two very important events took place, which had and still has a very big effect on the Nile question in the future up till today and will be in the forthcoming years or even decades. The first important issue was the Sudani referendum, where South Sudan became independent of Sudan. Sudan, in fact, became two countries. This involved Sudan in a lot of internal problems, made Sudan face one of its worst economic crises. Sudan lost all of its resources in one in one event, because all the oil which Sudan built the whole economy, its economy on in the previous years, emerged, in fact, was found in South Sudan. So all the oil wells and everything got lost for Sudan. Sudan had to look for alternatives, so Sudan was very busy with its own problems. The second thing was, of course, the January 25 revolution in Egypt, which overthrew the reign of Hosni Mubarak and created a turmoil in the country and a very big political crisis which lasted until 2013, for the next coming years. Within all these events happening, Ethiopia unilaterally announced its project, its big project, and laid down the basis of building the GERD in April 2011. My own point of view is that it wasn't by chance for Ethiopia to choose this date. In fact, Ethiopia knew that the timing was very important because neither Egypt nor Sudan would have the necessary tools or could take the necessary steps to stop this. And Ethiopia was working on time. Ethiopia thought that they will finish this dam up till 2017. So when Egypt will recover from the crisis, they will have already built about 50-60% of the dam. So it will be a fact and nothing to negotiate about it. So it will be de facto, it will be there. So this is where everything started. And so this is the problem. I would like to talk about the problem exactly. So Ethiopia, in 2011, started to build a dam on the Nile. So this became a source of conflict between the upstream countries, let's say between Ethiopia as an upstream country, and the downstream countries, Egypt and Sudan. So there is a water sharing issue, a water sharing problem here, because no basin-wide regulation accepted by all riparian countries existed. I will talk briefly, maybe later there will be a slide about it, but about the treaties which regulate the utilization of water of the Nile. So we have three agreements, which one dates back to 1902 between Egypt and Britain under the colonial era, and the other one dates back to 1929, also between Britain and Egypt. Also, Ethiopia doesn't recognize it. And the last one, the latest one, is 1959, which is between Sudan and Egypt sharing the water of the Nile. The main problem is that Ethiopia didn't sign any of these agreements. So for Ethiopia, they don't exist. So Ethiopia says that, in fact, nothing regulates the usage of the Nile. Egypt and Sudan are using the water and we are not using it. So why not? Now here comes the problem that there should be some kind of regulation about this, and they go back to the Helsinki Agreement, which goes back to 1966, where there are two articles which is very controversial. But I will talk about that later. Let's go back again. So the hegemony of Egypt, this is what Ethiopia says, in the Nile Basin is unacceptable, so this hegemony gets challenged with this dam. So I would like to focus here in Egypt. I would not like to go, this needs a separate lecture, to talk about Ethiopia and Ethiopian development and really why does Ethiopia needs very, very much this dam, but that's for another lecture. Now I would like to focus on Egypt and the challenges that Egypt has to conduct in the near future. So intensively I'm monitoring the media and I'm seeing that Egypt is really in trouble now. Let's see why. So first of all, to talk about this issue, we have to know the geography of the Nile and the very special characteristics of the river itself. So the Nile, which we call it as one river, in fact, it has two tributaries. One of them, which is the longer one, comes from Victoria Lake, comes from the south. This is the White Nile, as we can see here. And the other one, which is the more important one, is the Blue Nile that comes from Lake Tana in Ethiopia. So the longest river on Earth, it's about almost 7,000 kilometers, not suitable for large-scale shipping, as we know that it's an agricultural, that's why I call it an agricultural river. So we have downstream countries for Ethiopia are two countries, which are Egypt and Sudan. 85% of the water comes from the Blue Nile. That means it comes from Ethiopia. And 15% only comes from Lake Victoria. And both these two Nile tributaries meet here in Khartoum to go upwards to the Mediterranean as the main known Nile River. So what makes the Nile so special? The Nile, apart from being the longest and the oldest river on Earth, let's see, compare the flowing of the flow of these rivers. First one is the Amazonas, as we see. Here it has the flow of 175,000 cubic meters per second. It is the fastest river in the world. Its length is a little bit shorter than the Nile, but its flow is really huge. So, and it's the speed is really amazing, the speed of the river. Now the Nile, just look at the pace of the flowing here and the speed of the flowing, it's much slower. The Nile is only 2,700 cubic meters per second, which makes it even slower, the flowing of water slower than the Mississippi River in the United States of America, which has about 16,200 cubic meters per second. So if we make a comparison, so the Amazon flows 65 times greater than the Nile, and even the Mississippi flows 6 times greater than the Nile. So we have real social challenges in the Nile Valley. We have 11 riparian countries, as it used to be with every international river. We have 11 riparian countries, and the overall population can reach, of course, the number is just an estimation, but about 400, 450 million people living in the basin of the Nile. So they are directly, though this is the population directly affected by any change, any damage, or any modification in the flood of the river. So we have directly 160 million people. So I'm talking about 400 million on a wide scale. But directly affected are the populations of Egypt, Sudan, and of course, benefited are the population of Ethiopia. So what are the challenges, social challenges? So let's see, swift increase of population in every country. We know that if we look at here this the statistics, we see that in as we look at Ethiopia, in 1950, the population was 80 million. In 2017, 105 million. And in 2030, it is expected to reach 140 million. People. So Egypt is not trailing Ethiopia by much. Ethiopia, Egypt was 21 million in 1950. 2017 it was 98 million, and in 2030 expected to be 120 million. We have about 2 million increase per year in the population of Egypt. We have also Uganda, which shows us a big booming in a demographic booming. We have Uganda was only 5 million, for example, in 1950, and is expected to be 64 million in 2030. Sudan is directly affected by the Nile because it's a downstream country. Of course, Sudan lost a part of its population because of South Sudan got independent in 2011, but still Sudan expected to have 55 million in 2030. South Sudan, which is not so directly affected by the GERD project, also will is showing a little bit decrease in increase in population. Of course, this increase in population brings with it increase in food consumption, intensive agricultural usage, including fishing. Of course, this project on the Nile affects and hits a lot the fishing agricultural field. We have also increasing in water consumption, but please let's think about one thing. All these are natural resources. All natural resources are limited. So we are talking about a huge increase in population and with time decrease in these natural resources. So this is the problem we are facing. And we see that we have also increasing environmental concerns. For example, we have pollution, we have booming in the populated areas. Let's not talk about climate change, desertation, and other things that is hitting the region really very hard. So we have a region, all this happening, this demographic boom, and this scarcity of natural resources happening in a region full with political and social conflicts. Some of them, Arab Spring, conflict of Ethiopia and Eritrea, power shifts in Sudan and Egypt, 2011, 2013, and the latest one, which is the civil war in Ethiopia between the Tigrinians and the Ethiopian federal government. And really, these things don't make the problem easier. They just make it more complicated. This is like the hen and the egg quadrant. So which one was first? So the social and political issues were first, or the scarcity of natural resources? I think that both problems strengthen each other. So I talked about this in my introduction. So I will just say that this is the demo of the dam. It's the largest water management project in Africa, the largest hydroelectric plant in Africa, and the eighth largest in the world. Some specifications for the sake of those who like engineering topics. So this is a almost 2 kilometers long dam, so 1,780 meters long, and the height of the dam is 155 meters. I'm talking about the main dam, the concrete dam, the picture of which we are seeing now. And behind the dam, it gives a space of almost 2 square kilometers, 1874 kilometer square reservoir. This is where the water behind the dam is saved. So we have this reservoir, fills in 74 billion cubic meters of water inside. Just for comparison, this is the total water consumption, annual water consumption of Egypt and Sudan. So the lake, I call it the lake because it's bigger than a reservoir, it's really a lake. So it holds back the same amount of water that both Egypt and Sudan get in 1 year. Of course, we can say that the flow of the river is a little bit small. That's why the whole Nile gives about 80 billion cubic meters per year, as we see that only Egypt and Sudan are utilizing the Nile. Inauguration of the GERD was planned to be in 2017, but will be, hopefully for Ethiopia, in 2023. So partly will be in operation in 2020, is in operation in 2020. Now we got the second fill this year. There are huge delays. Huge delays because the local construction firms did not have any sufficient experience at the beginning. So that's why then later it was given. So this is the picture of the dam. So it was delivered to an Italian company, the Salini Costruttato. This is an Italian company, one of the biggest mega project building companies. So this is the, as you can see, this is right now anyway. So this is the filling of the dam. This is the reservoir. We have here this is the main dam here. This is the main dam. We call it the concrete dam. Here is a spillway. This gets rid of unnecessary water. When the level of the reservoir is too high, they just open it so that the water can flow back to the mainstream of the Nile. And here we have the so-called saddle dam, which is built up of the bedrock and the rocks extracted from the bedrock, from the ground, during building the main dam. So this is also about 4.8 kilometers long. And the other parts of the dam are, we can call them, are natural saddles, so they are natural boundaries for the reservoir. So these are the three projects, in fact, the concrete, the spillway, and the saddle dam. financing the project. As we see, this is a really, really very big mega project. So the problem at the beginning was, and I would like to stop at this slide a little bit, the problem was funding the dam. Since this was a very controversial project, no international financial institution was interested in funding it, partly due to the pressure done by Egypt on these institutions. They did not want, neither the IMF nor the World Bank, they did not want to get involved in such a controversial project where the revenues are so unstable and where things can escalate to elsewhere, war or whatever. So the international financial institutes didn't want to take place. Didn't want to take share of this project. This is where Miles Zinavi's idea came, or saw daylight, as we say, that the Ethiopian people will contribute to this dam. This is a national project, so the PR started very early at the end of the 2009-2010, the PR for the project. So every Ethiopian person should contribute to building this dam. So this is a national and merely a national project. So we don't want to take money from anyone. We don't need anyone to help us in our problem. We will solve it on a local level. So the cost of this is more than $5 billion, estimated at the beginning to be 4.5. So currently it stands at about 4.8 billion with about more than 80% of the dam finished. So this is the most expensive water management project in Africa. As I said, no direct international sponsors. So why? Because the project, as I said, is controversial. The bond programs. This was the Zinavi's idea. Let's go to the bond project. This is the program for the Ethiopians. They can buy state bonds for an amount of money, which was, I think, $500 at the beginning. It was a lot. And this led to some unsuccess of this project. Later on, in 2012, 2013, this was reduced to $50 per Ethiopian person. And it really targeted the Ethiopian labor working abroad, outside the country. So nobody can transfer back any money to Ethiopia without the government taking its share, taking these 50 bonds. Everybody had to contribute to the project. Of course, the Ethiopians, this was a little bit surprising that in a country like Ethiopia, it's a diversity of everything. You can find everything in Ethiopia, many nations, many religions, but really they just gathered and they got united around this project, and it had no problems because every Ethiopian person could afford it. And I know a lot of Ethiopian friends of mine who were really happy to pay this $50. And this led to the construction of more than 60% of the dam. So so the project itself was funded by Ethiopians. This money, they could collect about $1.52 billion from this bond programs. And the other part was by Chinese investments and so on. But let's not run forward. So the project manager, you see this gentleman here, he was the project manager, engineer who, for very regretful reasons, committed suicide in 2018, found shot in his own vehicle in the center of Addis Ababa. So he committed suicide as the police investigations concluded. So he was the main, he was the main manager of the project. So a lot of rumors were that Egypt had a hand in that, and et cetera. But I think, in my opinion, the reason of his suicide was that because really things went south for the project in 2017, 2018. I understand by that there was no more money and the project wasn't finished. They should have delivered the dam in 2017, delayed to 2018. There has been a resignation of the Prime Minister of Ethiopia in 2018 and a new one from a totally different cultural background, Abiy Ahmed, was elected. So all these problems, I think, that resulted in this gentleman could not bear this way on his shoulders, so he decided to pass away. I think this is the real reason behind his death, and not as a lot of people say that Egypt killed him or whatever. So these are just rumors, and the investigations of the Ethiopian police also got to this result. So in 2018. The Ethiopian Prime Minister changed the project manager and gave it to the Italian costruttori, Salini Costruttori. So by October 2018, the project should have been delivered, but could not. And here there is a speech for Abiy Ahmed, who blamed there was a real risk that the project will never be finished at that time. And Abiy Ahmed blamed the army, blamed the previous leaders of the country, especially the Tigrinyans, so because they were leading the country in the previous years. So he just said, I'm not responsible for that. I'm here to fix things, and let's see. But if it doesn't get fixed, it's not my problem. So this was the real message of Abiy Ahmed by that time. Now, the communication of Ethiopia. For example, what does Ethiopia say to the world? So I'm building a dam. This dam will cause a very big shortage of water in the downstream countries. So how am I supposed to deliver this to the world? So they say, we are improving the image of the project to gather international supporters. This is very important. We have to improve the image of the project. They say, the Ethiopians say, GERD is an African development project, beneficial to everyone. What Ethiopia communicates, in fact, here is that it's not only beneficial for Ethiopia, apart from delivering electricity to almost 6 million households in Ethiopia, which means that right now, 65% of the population of Ethiopia are without electricity right now. This project solves the problem. Apart from that, the Ethiopians say that this is not a local or a national project. This is an international mega project which will deliver electricity to countries like Uganda, Burundi, Kenya, Tanzania, which will solve the problem of these countries, most of the problems of these countries, and will put them on the right track of development. Convincing Sudan, at the beginning Ethiopia targeted on convincing Sudan that this is beneficial for Sudan. In fact, it is beneficial. It could be beneficial for Sudan, but let me leave this for a later time. And Ethiopia worked on isolating Egypt. So Ethiopia's strategy was to leave Egypt alone, isolating it, and all the other countries will be backing Ethiopia in this project. So forcing them to negotiate at one time, offering them cheap electricity at another time. So this was Ethiopia's strategy. As we see by the 2000s, with the new millennia, we see that there is a new actor in Africa, a very serious actor, which is Ethiopia, a really developing power, regional power. And if the country stays in one piece, it will be really a significant regional power in the near future. Traditionally and historically, Egypt is the main beneficiary of the Nile. Egypt was, for many years, the only and the most powerful regional state in the whole Africa and Middle East territory. Now things are changing. In fact, Ethiopia is coming up, and coming up very quickly. One of the most important aspects of this whole conflict is that Egypt has no leverage on Ethiopia. So Egypt has nothing to bargain with. So Egypt has nothing to give Ethiopia. So that's why the whole negotiation process, which has been taking since 2012 up till April, the last negotiation round was in April, Egypt could not offer anything. So everybody is right. Everyone is right. So nobody is wrong here. But somehow we have to distribute the water of this one source. So here comes that Ethiopia is now a power in Eastern Africa. And not only Ethiopia, we see development in all the upstream countries. So we see the population center of the Nile is shifting towards from the downstream countries to the upstream countries. Ethiopian economic and population growth, we have seen in the last 10 years, let's say, a big growth in economic and population level in Ethiopia. But Ethiopia has a very weak energy infrastructure. So 60%, I said 65, that of the population doesn't have access to electricity. And I've seen a very important and a very interesting report about this conducted by the Arabic television Al Jazeera. One of the reporters visited the villages in Ethiopia, and a lot of people said, we don't know what is electricity. We have never seen electricity. So that's why Ethiopia had a serious problem with this. It wants to be an important country in the region. It is now, but it wants to be more important. So they have to solve this infrastructural problem. So it has constant water cuts, constant power cuts, no electricity in the country. It could be the richest country in electricity in all Africa, but because of the lack of the proper infrastructural background, it doesn't. So let's see, how does Ethiopia generate its electricity, its current electricity? Fossil fuels less than 1% compared to Africa as a continent, 80%. Ethiopia is not utilizing fossil fuels at all. Hydro, 93%, which is much higher than the African average, which only reaches 15%. Nuclear, of course, zero. And wind is really good. 6% of its electricity is from wind. And it's higher than the African level, that is 2%. We have less than 1% solar, geothermal, and biomass electricity and power sources. Energy management of Ethiopia. The plant capacity of the GERD is 6,450 megawatts of electricity. Just for comparison, this is Egypt's Aswan Dam. They call it the Nasser Dam as well. So captures behind it a volume of what the reservoir of this dam is 162 billion cubic meters of the Aswan Dam, and can only produce an energy of 2,100 megawatts. Ethiopia's Renaissance Dam, on the other hand, holds back 75 million cubic meters of water, but gives 6,450 megawatts of electricity. So this is a much more developed, much more modern project. This amount of electricity, enough for 6 million households, as I have said, capable of the capacity of 6 nuclear power plants. If you look at the Paks power plant here in Hungary, it doesn't deliver more than 2,000, I think. So this is really, really a very big project. 2,000 megawatt electricity is planned to be exported. Right now, Ethiopia has about, the current electricity production is 4,000. Ethiopia will need about 4,000 or 4,500, and the rest will be sold abroad in the countries in the vicinity of Ethiopia. Supports the independent power management of Ethiopia. Ethiopia will be definitely an independent powerful state in sense of electricity. To take a small glance at the domestic politics in Ethiopia, Abiy Ahmed, who is the winner of the Nobel Prize in 2019, was elected in 2018, and he is of the Oromo background and not a Tigrayan one. In June 2019, there was a coup attempt in Ethiopia, which was successfully brought down by the Ethiopian government, that there was this coup attempt. Oromo population, from where Abiy Ahmed comes, is about 40% the population of the country. And they are against Abiy Ahmed. In fact, the Tigrayans are against Abiy Ahmed. So new democratic leadership and rejection of dictatorship. This is one of the most important communications of Abiy Ahmed, that no more dictators, and we will lead a democratic country. But the problem is that we have three major here we see, we have three, the Oromia, we have the Tigray is here, we have the Amhara. So this is the three main important nationalities of racial backgrounds and racial territories in Ethiopia. So we see that the Tigrinians, where right now the civil war is occurring between the Ethiopian National Federal Army and the Tigrinian rebels. They call themselves Tigrinian rebels, or the Independent Army of Tigray. So the Tigrinians hold power on Ethiopia for more than 25 years, since Meles Zenawi and his successor Desai, and up until the rising of Abiy Ahmed. So we see that ethnic composition of Ethiopia is very diverse. We have a lot of ethnic groups, a lot of territories, so this is a real federation of these ethnic groups. That's why I always used to say that Ethiopia is, by its sense, is a vulnerable country. But as long as there is one mega project like this which unites the country, Ethiopia, I think, will remain one country, but let's hope so. Transformation in Egypt. Now, I turn to the main point of my lecture, which is about Egypt. I just had to go to this brief introduction about Ethiopia, because we have to understand both parties of the conflict. In 2011, just brief history, Egyptian revolution, end of the Mubarak regime, we have seen that Ethiopia made the first step by laying the basis of starting building the great Renaissance Dam. Between 2011 and 2013, we have seen the Muslim Brotherhood government in Egypt, which ended in 2013 by the big June 30th revolution. So Egypt plans a military attack against the GERD, and this is important because we have three approaches from Egypt towards this project. The first one was by the Mubarak regime, which ignored the project totally, so it doesn't exist. Even there is, I have read it in Arabic, there is a document from the head of the military intelligence by that time, Omar Suleiman, who also passed away in 2012. He was the one who read the declaration of Mubarak's resignation on TV. So he was a very famous person. So he was the head of the military intelligence. He just passed a document to Mubarak which contained a full plan of how will Egypt attack Ethiopia's dam if it is built ever. So, but this was the Mubarak's standpoint. There is no dam, there is no problem. But after the Egyptian revolution and the effective building of the dam, when Egypt and Ethiopia started to build the dam in reality, Egypt on a sudden had to deal with this problem. The Muslim Brotherhood's approach was threatening military operations, and they just even threatened Ethiopia of bombing the dam. So this didn't last long. For other reasons, not for this reason, but the Muslim Brotherhood government was overthrown in June 30, 2013, and this showed the end of Morsi government. Since 2013, we have the Sisi government, which conducts negotiations with Ethiopia, endless negotiations with Ethiopia, but no success. Here we have to talk. Let's see. This was Mubarak, and this was the revolution in 2011. A similar revolution took place in 2013 when the Muslim Brotherhoods were overthrown. So when the Muslim Brotherhoods lost power in Egypt in 2013. There was a transitional government in Egypt led by the transitional president was the judge of the, I think, constitutional court, was the head of the Constitutional Court. Anyway, I met him in 2015. He was here in a visit to Budapest, and I met him. During this period, negotiations, the type of cooperation started between Egypt and Ethiopia. There have been 4 or 5 rounds of negotiations between November 2013 and May 2014. And this paved the way for the later approach of Abdel Fattah al-Sisi, president, who just said, okay, we would like to sit on a table and talk about this. So we will negotiate. We will not use any controversial or threatening language. We will agree with Ethiopia. We will reach an agreement. Here, let's go back a little bit. So when this problem emerged in 2011, Egypt and Sudan recommended the establishing of an IPOE, so International Plenary of Experts, for studying and conducting a study about the dam and its possible damages on the downstream countries. So this plenary of experts conducted a study between May 2012 and May 2013. And in fact, the problem with Egypt was that what Egypt was negotiating about is that Ethiopia should stop building the dam until we see that the results conducted by these experts are studied much well. So what did the experts say? They said that this project in fact caused damages in the Nile, changes the flow of water, can cause damage for the downstream countries, especially in the drought periods, and filling the reservoir is problematic, and there should be some kind of agreement between the governments, between the states, which are affected by that. Here, Ethiopia went on in building the dam. Egypt was requesting to stop building the dam until we conduct further studies and we reach kind of an agreement. You have the right to build the dam, but let's reach an agreement on how you build it without causing much damage and destruction to us. This is what Ethiopia did not do. Here we have these agreements which I talked about, and we have the third agreement, which is the latest one in 1959, so which gives Egypt 55.5 billion cubic meters of water annually, Sudan 18.5, and in fact the remaining 10 billion cubic meters of the Nile water evaporates just. So we can say that only 2 countries have been utilizing the river, and Ethiopia got 0% of the water. So here in concerning the international regulations on water management, in 1999, Nile Basin Initiative saw daylight. So this is an initiative within the Nile Basin countries, and it's called also the Nile Basin Cooperative Framework. It was in Entebbe in 2010. So the agreement of Entebbe, Uganda, CFA, is the abbreviation of Cooperative Framework Agreement, Egypt and Sudan were not signatories, so they did not take part. So they just left the negotiations, and they didn't participate in this agreement. So they are not. This agreement excludes Egypt and Sudan. In 2015, another turning point. So between 2011 and 2015, we have seen 2 approaches. First by the Muslim Brotherhoods, so it was a little bit hostile to Ethiopia. It was really hostile to Ethiopia, but this didn't last long. During the transitional government between June 2013 and June 2014, there have been negotiations. There was kind of cooperation between Egypt and Ethiopia, bilateral cooperation. At this stage, Sudan didn't take part that effectively. But in June of 2014, Sisi took power in Egypt and declared his new strategy in the negotiation process with Ethiopia. So in 2015, March 2015, there was the memorandum of understanding between, we call it also the cooperation agreement between Egypt, Ethiopia, and Sudan. So Ethiopia, which Egypt said that Ethiopia has the right to use its own territorial water, and this was implemented in the agreement. So this was very important for Ethiopia, still using this memorandum of understanding, and still uses, this is a nice picture, so about the caricatorial picture, so. Yeah, and Ethiopia still really uses this understanding to say that, okay, Egypt recognized our right in utilizing the river, so we have the right to build the dam. So, the basis of negotiations for Egypt. What are the basis of negotiations? What are the stands and the pillars which the Egyptian parties stand on? First of all, Egypt says, we have the historical right to possess water. So this is a historical right, of course. Right to the Nile is found in the constitution of Egypt. Problem here is that no other regulation or agreement states this. So it doesn't have a real international power, so this historical right to the Nile. Yes, we know, all of us know, that Egypt was born on the Nile. Egypt is the Nile, and the Nile is Egypt. Even Herodotus said that during the Roman Empire, so 2,000 years ago. So Egypt is the Nile. Okay, but today we have international law frames, we have legal procedures, we have agreements. So this is not that big, powerful tool in Egypt's hands to say, okay, just to lay on our historical rights in possessing water. Though, this is the truth. So Egypt, the whole Egyptian culture is built on the Nile. So if you deprive Egypt of the Nile, you kill Egypt. So that's the dilemma here. The next thing is Egypt as the largest user of the Nile water, but not, there is no basin-wide agreement for that. The third basis for Egypt is seeking the support of international organizations. So for its own right, Egypt always turns to the Arab League, African Union, UN, IGAD, Intergovernmental Authority on Development. So these are the institutions Egypt keeps on turning to whenever there is a problem with Ethiopia. So undermining the support of the dam, this is also one of the strategy of Egypt. And here comes, so is this effective? Let's see, opportunities for Egypt. So first of all, destroying the dam. I don't think that this is a realistic option for Egypt, because it is an enormous and political and environmental cost. So it is really a costly thing. Of course, militarily, Egypt can do it. Egypt is by far has the most powerful military in Africa and in the Middle East as well. So Egypt can do it. Right now, Egypt has bases in South Sudan. So the Egyptian army, for example, is training the South Sudanese army. And Egypt has very good relations with the current Sudani government. So if we are talking about the capability of Egypt to conduct a military strike on the dam, yes, it's possible for Egypt. But what are the consequences? I think the consequences are, and the price Egypt will have to pay if it takes such a step, will be very, very high, so costful. But still there is a question. What if I can drink? What if there is an internal turmoil? What if there will be a revolution? What if there are huge migration, internal and external migration waves? So if those things happen, and we will see the scenarios for Egypt, if those things happen, what is the better bad thing? Which one is worse, let's say, from the other angle? To die from thirsty and to live in a civil war in Egypt where the government is overthrown, or to attack Ethiopia? So if Egypt has such a choice, or if Egypt really is put in the corner up to this level, then I think that still the military strike is on the table. Now, what is Egypt doing? Egypt is strengthening its military, and not only by words. Egypt is buying super modern and powerful Rafale jets from France. Egypt has also bought brand new weaponry and armament from the United States. And up till now, till the Biden administration in America, Egypt enjoyed, let's say, support. I don't want to say full support, but support of President Trump and his administration. So Egypt thinks from the powerful angle. Egypt thinks that I'm the powerful party here in this region. So if anything affects me that negatively, so there is a point under which I will not go. So there is a line Ethiopia should not cross. Egypt keeps on saying that. So I think the military option is still on the table and will be on the table until there will be a final agreement on utilizing the river. And ladies and gentlemen, we are seeing now, what we are witnessing now is the first real war for water in the 21st century. So this is the first real war, though we are not seeing war as we get used to it. So there are no weapons, there is no fight, and there is no direct war between the two countries. But the place the negotiations have reached, and really the negotiations are stuck. So I can say it reached a deadlock. So what will break this deadlock? So Ethiopia is buying time. So negotiating, endless negotiation, and negotiating, and what? And what? Egypt has no time. Just keep this in consideration. We should keep this in mind. Egypt has no time. Ethiopia has time. Ethiopia is building the project while negotiating. On the other hand, Egypt is losing every day. So what's going to happen? So there has been a turning point now this summer. This was the second fill of the reservoir happened. And we don't get a precise number of how much water was filled in the reservoir. What Ethiopia says, as the Minister of Water and Irrigation of Ethiopia announced about 1 month ago, what he said is that the filling was successful. So right now there are about 18.5 billion cubic meters in the reservoir. On the other hand, the Egyptians said that this unilateral attempt by Ethiopia to fill the reservoir failed, and due to environmental and technical issues, they could not fill more than 4 or 5 billion cubic meters. That means that right now, all the water in the dam, the sum of water is about 9 billion cubic meters compared to the 18.5 billion cubic meters announced by or declared by Ethiopia. So we don't know exactly how much water is right now in the reservoir. We have two different standpoints on this. Sudan as well complicated the question more, because Sudan said that, okay, we have our fears, but right now there are also benefits that the guard will in fact organize the flow of the river, and if we get data from Ethiopia, then this is good for us, because we will know exactly how much water we will expect and from the Nile, and there will be no more floods in Sudan, for example, which has been a problem for many years. So here Sudan complicated things and just mixes up everything, because Sudan wants, in one stance it's with Egypt, in the other stance it's with Ethiopia, so Sudan is standing somehow in between the two. So let's talk about the military thing, the military issue. The military issue is on the table. Though I think that it is a very high cost for Egypt, but we can never exclude it. The second option, opportunity, is holding up the construction of the dam. I don't think that there is any real chance for this, because it's indirectly by creating uncertainty for the investors, launching an international campaign against the dam. This already happened, and Egypt failed in reaching the expected results by this thing. So the dam is, I think, within 1 year it will be 100% complete. And still the turbines, implementing the turbines, that's another thing. But right now the construction procedure has been done, and right now they are just, we have now two turbines anyway functioning. So we have the overall 16 turbines, two of them are already functioning. I think that within 2023, the dam will be working in full capacity. So the third opportunity is, I call it, this is the most realistic target, seeking an agreement on the filling up of the reservoir behind the dam. So this is realistic and this is logical, but if we look at the negotiations here, we see that this is damn difficult, very difficult to do so. So high level of meetings since 2013. Trust building is a key factor, government leaders, foreign ministers, intelligence leaders, and engineers. So a wide scale of everything. All types of meetings have been held for years. On March 2015, defining the basis of negotiation between Egypt and Ethiopia, so Egypt accepts the fact that the dam will be built, recognizes the right of Ethiopia to develop its country and its population, and to, in fact, to build the dam. But there is also one more thing included in this memorandum of understanding, is that it should not be, it should not cause any damage for other countries. Now, this is the controversial thing. So negotiations since then cover the technical aspects. From 2015 until now, we have reached the third stage. First one was the threatening, second one was type of cooperation, and the third one now is they are only negotiating technical aspects. They are no more negotiating about the rights of Ethiopia, the rights of Egypt. So the dam is there, the dam is a fact, it's unchangeable, but now they are negotiating only on the technical level. So critics in Egypt say that the current government did very wrong when they recognized Ethiopia's right to utilize the Nile in 2015. By this, they just played a free card. Sisi played a free card to Ethiopia. This is what the critics of Sisi say. On the other hand, people say that this was the only way which the Sisi government could go, because Sisi government is a peaceful government. Sisi doesn't want war with anybody. So Sisi will try everything, every peaceful solution, and will do all he can to enhance the peaceful negotiations with Ethiopia, because the military option is really not an option. This is the pro and contra. In August 2017, trilateral negotiations really started, because up till that point, it was a bilateral negotiations, but trilateral negotiations, Ethiopia, Egypt, and Sudan, on the potential effect of the GERD impact study took place, economic, social, and environmental impact. But there was a huge mass of distrust between the parties. These parties tried to underline their own political opinion by the impact study. So there has been an impact study conducted by a French company, which is called the BRL, French company, conducted a study, which lists a lot of things, so beneficial and non-beneficial things. But each party really understood what it wants from this study. So Egypt emphasized on the destruction and the damage caused by the Nile. Ethiopia emphasized the beneficial things, development, electricity, power, whatever. So Egypt also recommended stop the building of the dam until we study the results of this committee, of this work. But Ethiopia never stopped building the dam. So what Ethiopia is doing, in fact, negotiating while building the dam. So this is, I think, so this is a moral question. So if we're negotiating about one thing, let's just stop everything and until we reach an agreement, we should stop building the dam. And that's not what Ethiopia doing. In November 2017, Egypt leaves the negotiations. And delay of the project leaves space for negotiations. There has been a one-year space to continue negotiations. So right now, Ethiopia still rejects Egypt's claims. Egypt has no legal asset, in fact. Egypt cannot appeal to the International Court of Justice as well. In October 2019, Putin wanted to play the role of mediator in this conflict. There have been the Sochi Russian Africa Summit. So it reflected light on the Russian interest in the negotiations, but still no results. On the 5th of October 2019, a failure of the last ministerial summit, Egypt is seeking US mediation, which in fact happened because the US stance, the United States under the Trump administration had a special standpoint on this issue. They really considered it of high importance. So the Trump administration emphasized the importance of reaching a deal, offered concessions for all parties. One of them was a $5 billion package to Ethiopia, offered by Donald Trump himself, hosting negotiations and playing the role of the mediator together with the World Bank. Reaching a deal was essential for the Trump government, Trump administration. Why? Because it is a part of the broader and the wide Middle East peace project. We have seen that some Arabic countries reached a peace deal with Israel, namely Morocco, Bahrain, UAE, and Sudan. So this could happen with a very important role Egypt played in this process. As for compensation, the American government was holding these negotiations in favor of Egypt. So America enhanced an agreement because Egypt was helping America a lot in making the Israeli-Arab peace. Israel was a key role player in that procedure, Egypt, in the Israeli-Arab peace process. So the Trump administration wanted to grant Egypt an agreement with Ethiopia. This did not happen because Egypt signed the first draft of the agreement on the 1st of February 2020. And Ethiopia refused to sign, and on the tongue of the foreign minister, who said that we feel very sorry that the American mediation was in favor of Egypt. So the agreement draft conducted by the Americans is unacceptable to us. That's what he said. And Ethiopia just stand off the table and negotiations stopped. These negotiations took place in Washington between Washington, D.C., between September 2019 and February 2020. Right now, we have a draft agreement signed in its first letters by Egypt and not signed, rejected totally by Ethiopia. Sudan also sent its remarks asking for some modifications in the agreement. So there has been an agreement which is only signed by Egypt. And unfortunately, no final agreement has been reached. So the current state of filling, let's see now where are things standing. So by summer of 2020, we have 4.9 billion cubic meters. Summer of 2021, we have 13.5 billion cubic meters, according to Ethiopian data. Altogether, Ethiopia says we have 18.4 billion cubic meters out of 74. According to Egyptian resources, it's only 7, 8, maybe 9 altogether. This is a very brief comparison of the Ethiopian and the Egyptian army. So we see that Egypt has a much greater armed forces than Ethiopia. So in case of a military conflict, there is no question who will win the direct conflict, the war between the two countries, but upon what costs. So filling periods and their impacts on Egypt. Now, this is the most crucial part of the whole problem. So, in fact, there are different scenarios. Each one of them is bad to Egypt, but there is much, much, much worse, and there is acceptable bad. So the minimum is 3 years. Ethiopia was first asking for 3 years. They want to fill the dam in 3 years. So this is a catastrophe to Egypt. This will lead to 30 billion cubic meter degrees of water supply. So right now, Egypt is getting 55.5 billion per year. So Egypt will get 25 billion per year, which right now the needs of Egypt is 80 billion cubic meters, the minimum needs of Egypt. Right now, Egypt is suffering from water deficit in the current situation. And it has been suffering from water deficit for the past years. So just imagine a 30 million cubic meter degrees of water supply. This means that half of the agricultural lands will dry, will just simply dry. It means that the rate of unemployment in Egypt will rise up to 25-26%, which will put huge pressure on the Egyptian government and on the whole region as a whole. We could see internal migration waves inside Egypt from the rural lands in Upper Egypt upwards, in Egyptian perspective, downwards, so up to the delta. The delta is already hosts 40 million people. So the population of the delta is between 40 and 50 million, in fact, and increasing. So imagine that the rest of the other 40, 50 million move towards the delta. The delta couldn't handle this, will not be able to handle this. No Egyptian government will be able to handle this scenario of filling the reservoir in 3 years. And this is in the best case. The worst case, if, for example, there are drought years, that will be more catastrophic. The other one, in fact, we have a five-year also. We have a five-year period. But what they are negotiating about is a six-year period. So 15 billion cubic meters degrees of water supply, and 17% of agricultural lands would dry. So this is also unacceptable for Egypt. This will cause the decrease of the amount of power produced by the Aswan Dam. So they have to release the water from the reservoir of the Aswan Dam to be used in households and agriculture, everything. So this will in fact shut down the production of electricity in Egypt. It will shut down totally the production of electricity. So this is also unexpectable and unnegotiable for Egypt. What Egypt wants is a 15-year long filling period, and even there has been a 21-year, which will be the best scenario for Egypt, because if it's 21 years, it will lose only about 2.5% of its agricultural lands. But these two, 15 and 21 years, are unnegotiable for Ethiopia. Now let's see all this I talked about in pictures. Filling periods. This is the 3 years filling period and its effect on the delta. I'm not talking about the direct effects of water shortages. No, I'm talking about the effects on the land of the delta. So we see that here are the two tributaries of the Nile, which at the end pour in the Mediterranean Sea. Now, what is going on and has been going on since building the Aswan Dam, is that the sediments of the Nile don't reach the delta. This causes the seawater to penetrate inside the delta, because the sediments of the Nile kept the water of the sea away from the delta. Now, no more sediments, which means that there is a saltification, the gradual saltification of the delta. This coast here, right now, this is the map of the delta. This is a satellite vision of the of the delta. We have here this coastal part. As you already see, it's yellow. So yellow means that it's deserty, it's sand. Why is that? Because the water is the water of the sea, the Mediterranean is pushing inwards. So here, if the reservoir of the GERD is filled in 3 years, this is what will happen. This is how the delta will look like. So, and I will leave this to your imagination. So about 40, 50 million people live here. Under these circumstances, it's difficult to live there. But imagine under this circumstance what will happen. So Egypt could lose 50%. Or 27 billion cubic meters of its total annual water budget, and 67%, about 6.750 million acres of agricultural area. So this is catastrophe. Now, this is the 5 years. If Ethiopia fills the reservoir in 5 years, 36% loss of water, resulting in 50% loss of agricultural land. So look at this. This is how the delta will look like. There is another problem with the delta. So the problem is that the delta is under big climate pressure as well. So we see that the climate change and desertation is hitting the delta very hard. So imagine removing the water coming from the Nile. 7 years scenario, 30% of the agricultural land loss. This is the 10 years. It is the closest acceptable things to Egypt, the 10 years. 14% of water budget, 18% of agricultural lands. As you see, all the 2 million acres lost, all these scenarios are bad for Egypt. If somebody is still wondering about the option of a military strike, believe me, so if one of these scenarios happen, Egypt will have no other choice. So there will be a war in the region. As I said before, this will be the first real war in the 21st century for water and for water resources. This is the 21 years option, which is Egypt pushing for. For Ethiopia, it will never happen. Why? Because Ethiopia has contracts. Ethiopia wants to sell electricity. Ethiopia invested $5 billion in the dam. Ethiopia has to pay back the bondholders. So has to buy back these bonds from the people and has to pay for the Chinese. Now we have international investments as well. So 21 years is unacceptable for Ethiopia. Right now, there is no agreement about that. To understand this more, we have to take a quick look at water resources in Egypt. Because, this is important, because many say that Egypt could solve its shortages of water internally. Let's see if this is possible or not. So the main question is here, how does Egypt manage its scarce water resources? Looking for the socio-political conditions and environmental challenges behind water scarcity in Egypt. Water policy challenges and management of water resources in Egypt. So, Egypt and the Nile, 96% of water consumption in Egypt comes from the Nile. Water supply, number one national priority for Egypt. 95 million people, about 99%, live alongside the Nile. 130 million population by 2040. 660 cubic meters water consumption per capita, which is under the poverty line, which is 1,000 cubic meter determined by the UN, and possibly goes below 350 cubic meters per capita during the years of filling the reservoir. The problem in Egypt, we have a demographic boom. We have an extensive and intensive growth in water demand, unsustainable water consumption, degradation of natural environment and the deterioration of human living conditions, Egypt's growing external and internal challenges in the last years. Here I can mention the Libyan conflict and the Sinai conflict. Organizational challenge, we have policy responses and governmental processes often lack long-term solutions and implementation of clear-cut strategies. These are, in brief, the problems in Egypt. The water crisis in Egypt, there are three sets of factors that are responsible for the water crisis in Egypt. Number one, which is the human factor, I also call it the social factor, population growth, a sudden increase in demand. Yearly, per capita water resources are only 663 cubic meter in 2013. Secondly, political factor, just to mention some, weak management, where politics overcome economic rationale, old water usage techniques, inefficiency, lack of private investment. And the third one is the natural factor. We have serious environmental challenges, deterioration of water resources, both in quality and quantity, and climate change. Now, let's see which sectors uses most water in Egypt. So the agriculture as the largest consumer of water in Egypt. So this is the green one, is the agriculture. Boof, everything is used in the agriculture, in irrigation. So we see that industry and municipalities, this is the household usage, it's only 13%. And we have a significant loss of water and evaporation of the Nile canals, 3%. One of the solutions could be just covering the canals to prevent evaporation during the hard summer period. Agriculture is very vulnerable in Egypt, a sector under constant challenge. Water supply is 96% dependent on the Nile. Agriculture is the largest water user, 80-85%. The amount of water used by irrigation agriculture is 59 billion cubic meter per year. Does anyone remember the share of Egypt's water from the Nile? 55.5. So agriculture itself uses more than Egypt's share of the Nile, of the water of the Nile. So 60% de facto consumed, and we have 40% loss due to inefficiencies. Inefficiencies here, by inefficiencies, I mean old sewage systems, bad management of water, of households, and the tubes, the whole networks is old. So this needs a lot of money to be improved and to be developed to reduce this 40% loss. This can be one of the counter, Egypt can encounter this problem with fixing these problems on the long term range, but this needs a lot of financial supplies, which Egypt right now is struggling for. So there is a constant fight against the desert. So we don't have to emphasize this more. Let's see some of the crops and what is using water a lot. We have sugar cane, tomatoes. Look at cotton here. 4,000 liters consumed by 1 kilogram of cotton. The rice here is 1,673. The rice, which has been banned in most territories of Egypt, only I think 6 provinces are allowed to cultivate the rice. So, decreasing agricultural capital in Egypt, we have seen that Egypt is one of the biggest importers of wheat right now. Does anyone remember from history that during the Roman Empire, it was the house of wheat, of crops, Egypt? So now Egypt is one of the biggest importers of the world in the world. Why? Because of the growth of population, natural resources limited, population is booming all the time. This is Egypt. I chose this picture to show you one thing, that how the desert is creeping and trying to consume agricultural lands. So only one line divides the dead desert from the living lands. And this is a very significant feature in Egypt. So this is the desert. The desert keeps creeping all the time. The invasion of the desert, I call it. So further challenges for water consumption. Population growth needs more intensive and extensive agriculture. Now here comes the point. So really this is the thing. Agriculture consumes a lot of water. Growth of population needs more agriculture. What do we do? What can be done? Egypt has lost roughly, up till now, 220,000 hectares of production land along the Nile due to urbanization. And urbanization is increasing. Cities, larger stress on water infrastructure. Because there is a loss in agricultural land, people are moving to cities. Here we talk about the increase of urbanization. Increase of urbanization lays much more pressure on the water infrastructure in the cities. So what happens? Physical water shortages in the dry period. So what happens in the cities because of these problems? We see illegal water pipes, we see overconsumption. Why is the government not encountering this or not fighting this? Because it will lead to a real turmoil in the cities if the government, because simply the people cannot afford to pay for the legal water pipes. So they cannot consume, they cannot afford to consume water legally. So that's why the government turns a blind eye on this. But this also leads to the loss of big amounts of water per year. The challenge of climate change, more irregularities in the flow of the Nile are expected. Desertation. So more people, more agriculture, more food needed. More food needed, more water needed. Because of the dam and for other internal factors, the water supply is becoming less and less and less every year. So this is the dilemma. Salination is also a big problem. Salination of the Nile Delta threatens 900,000 additional hectares of agricultural lands. This is due to sea intrusion. Now Egypt is, I call it a hydrocracy. Egyptian state narrative aims to control, allocate, and develop national resources, such as water, through mega projects. They always think in mega projects. In Egypt, this has been throughout history. If you look at the pyramids, you know what mega projects mean. So Egypt believes in mega projects. Domination of water resources by state institutions. Uses old patterns and, as I said, launched large-scale capacity expansion measures, the marginalization of local management. Water is considered a security Egypt in Egypt of the first kind. It's a real priority, a question of national interest. So who owns the water? The army is the largest political and economic stakeholder in Egypt, in everything. Historically influential institution, the most popular institution within the highest legitimacy. Hegemony monopoly in many areas, especially after 2013, where the army was the savior of the nation. Military involvement in agricultural and industrial projects. No accountability, and really the army benefits the mostly from the selective liberalization of the economy. The impact of state policy, let's see two examples. So we have overlapping institutional boundaries in water management in Egypt. Highly centralized water administration. We have two examples, the Aswan High Dam. It really regulates the flow of the dam, doubles the annual harvest through the dam. However, the river's fertile mud cannot reach the agricultural lands. Then the implementation of the new land law in 1997, also known as the Toshka project. Cessation of land tenure for the peasants. Almost a million peasants had to leave their lands. More than 800 tenants were killed in land disputes. So this wasn't really a successful project. Water management in Egypt, also water from the Nile, 15 USD cents per cubic meter of water. So it costs, the Nile water right now costs an Egyptian citizen 15 USD cents per cubic meter of water. After launching the GERD, at least 15%, we will see from the Nile, this means that there is a need for between 7.5 million and 20 million additional cubic water in Egypt. We have here water stress in Africa. This is a map, shows the amount of water in each country. Let's see alternative resources for Egypt apart from the Nile. Remember the number, 15 USD. This is how much one cubic meter from the Nile costs. Now, we go to water desalination. 8 desalination facilities are right now in Egypt. Each can produce 150,000 cubic meters per day. Currently, the total capacity per year is 0.4 billion cubic meters. So it's insignificant totally. So it costs 1 cubic meters of desalinated water for an Egyptian person will cost him 1.1 USD. Just let's go back to this number. This is much higher. 15 cents. So Egypt, this is also this 15 cents and $1.1. So this is, there is a really big difference. So desalinated water will be expensive for an ordinary Egyptian citizen to pay for. Egypt plans, on the other hand, Egypt plans to double the capacity of these facilities within 4 years. And I think it will be able to do so. But still, the cheapest water comes from the Nile. Secondly, apart, this was desalination. The second one is utilization of water resources from the desert wells. This is the internal water. Maximum, Egypt can get about 3-4 billion cubic meters annually. These aren't renewable water. This is the biggest problem, that these are not renewable water resources, and also too expensive. So if we see here, it's really too expensive to use well waters, desert waters for irrigation. The third one is wastewater management. The problem is no infrastructure of these activities. Huge investments are needed for long-term utilization, which Egypt has already started since 2019. But you see, it is still at the beginning. The conclusion, total amount of water that can be utilized, that Egypt can utilize by its own capacities, cannot be more than 4 or 5 billion cubic meters. Dot. So how much it will lose? We have seen the best scenario losing 8-10 billion. So this is a big problem. So the Egyptian water management sector is examined from three different angles. We have the infrastructural background, economic aspect, institutional basis, the political aspect, and international impact, the environmental aspect. So what are the strengths? Let's see the strengths of Egypt. Egypt has really a world-class agriculture. They cultivate everything. So Egypt has a dynamic youth population, very important. The relative stability of the government and the organizational capacity of the army. It is a stable country in the region, by no means. Significant natural resources, gas, wind, solar, and significant external income, tourism and remittances. And of course, I can add to this political stability and very good international relations. Peace treaty with Israel. So all these are points of power for Egypt. What are the weaknesses of Egypt? The land and water resources are limited. Continuous attempts at agricultural modernization always failed to modernize the agriculture. Monopolized hegemonic methods of governance, lost confidence in civil society and reliance on state institutions, especially the army, large inequalities within the society. Here we talk about poverty and unemployment. So opportunities. Egypt has far-reaching experience in agricultural technologies. Egypt developed friendly relations with many powerful countries, especially the United States of America and Western Europe. Natural resources such as gas, wind, and solar power. The threats on Egypt. The filling up period of the GERD will increase water shortages. We talked about this. Unfeasible mega projects distract valuable resources from specific problem-centric local solutions, the dominance of statist traditions, security threats from neighboring regions, Sudan and Libya. Now it seems that these things are getting solved, but still there is a threat always. Uncontrolled population growth and climate change. So a summary on water issues in Egypt. An integrated approach is necessary to deal with the complex water challenges Egypt is facing. I'm talking here, we talked about the external challenges through the GERD and the internal challenges through the problems we have talked about. The current political economy layout is not sustainable. So what is it? What do I mean by that? Highly politicized and centralized field with monopolies and ineffective management. Egypt has to break with the old production traditions, so they have to change their mode of life. A broad consensus and economic and political participation are needed. Otherwise, ineffective management patterns might reproduce themselves, and instability is what everyone fears in this question. So keeping the system alive while reforming from the inside. So this is this is really a dilemma. So this is what I wanted to talk about today. I just to wrap up everything, we talked about the GERD, the impacts of the GERD on Egypt, on the water resources of Egypt, agriculture in Egypt. And on the other hand, we discussed also the internal problems regarding water shortages in Egypt and the attempts to reform the agriculture and the water consumption networks. So this just to say that Egypt has its own big problem with this water issue and is taking, I don't say should take, because Egypt is really taking realistic measurements on decreasing the internal factors. So they are building desalination facilities, new networks, and so really Egypt is doing its best. But still, the one big problem is the external threat imposed by the GERD, which we cannot expect, and we cannot say which scenario will work at last. But we have two totally different standpoints on this one problem. So Ethiopia is playing its own game. Egypt is playing its own game. Sudan between the two, and there is no agreement. And what can one say? So should Egypt adapt to this new fact, to this new reality? If it can adapt, it will be very difficult. But on the other hand, I think that Ethiopia, this is my own opinion, Ethiopia should also give some concessions. Ethiopia should also try to cooperate much more with Egypt. Maybe Ethiopia will lose some financial resources because of that, but it will avoid a direct conflict with Egypt. On the other hand, I think all the three countries, Egypt, Ethiopia, and Sudan, should think of working together through the Nile Basin Initiative, all the countries together, to work out somehow a regional agreement between all the countries in the Nile Basin, and not only on building the GERD, on the case of the GERD dam, but also on future dams and future utilization of water, and also in the international, or let's say interregional development, which can be reached if these 11 countries could cooperate with each other and could put a really very clear legal framework to the structure of this cooperation. And otherwise, this will lead to endless conflicts in the region. No, not the UN and not the Security Council and not the EU. Those are not the institutions who will solve this problem. This problem can be solved only within the NBI, within the Nile Basin Initiative. So only the regional countries, the countries of the Nile, will have to cooperate, to work with each other somehow, to create a work process, an agreement, which will solve all these problems. Otherwise, now we are talking about the GERD, then we will talk Ethiopia. In fact, just to put this in mind, Ethiopia has the intention of building more dams. So Egypt is keeping in mind that if I play all my cards here and I allow Ethiopia to build a dam and to operate the dam as it wants, what will happen in the future? This will be a precedent. Egypt doesn't want a precedent to happen. So Egypt sticks to its water share. Ethiopia wants a water share. Somebody has to lose here. But the case is, who will lose the most? So who will lose the big one? Who will be the big loser? Nobody wants to be a big loser. Everyone now is trying to reach a win-win situation, but this cannot happen. Only it can happen to mitigate the impacts of this project and the future projects could be reached only by a kind of agreement between the Nile Basin countries. Thank you for your attention, and I hope that I wasn't so boring and I didn't extend my lecture so much. I planned an hour, it took almost 2 hours, so thank you very much. Thank you.
Yes, questions, remarks?
Yes, thank you so much, Dr. Rashed, for the very extensive, very thorough, and not boring at all, but very thorough overview. There are many issues, of course, you put together in an analytical piece, and while the others are thinking about questions and remarks, I have a couple, actually. The major point I would like to make here is that, you know, you were talking about, you know, Ethiopia playing its own game, you know, Egypt playing its own game, and so on. The whole issue, the entire issue, is a power game.
Exactly.
For a long time. And we are not surprised, we mustn't be surprised that, you know, I mean, the regional organizations, the international community, and everybody else, all the actors basically, of course, the Nile Basin Initiative countries and many others, are involved, would like to be involved in settling the dispute.
Exactly.
Because you know, I mean, it's a global security issue. It's not an issue between the two countries or the three countries. So, you know, this is a geopolitical game, yes. First of all, and there has been a geopolitical, big geopolitical shift going on. You pointed it right, you know, shifting from Egypt towards Ethiopia,
yes.
But without energy security, no chance.
Exactly.
To raise as a regional power for Ethiopia and the other way around.
Exactly.
Losing energy security, becoming more into an insecure position on behalf of Egypt, no chance to hold its position,
yes.
As a developmental pole in the wider region. So I think energy security is crucial, one of the issues of this geopolitical shift. And you showed us the energy matrix changing. You also mentioned Paksh, and you know, just one small remark.
Yes.
In the Hungarian case, I mean, 40% of the total Hungarian energy consumption is related to Paksh.
Exactly.
So if you have such a big deal over there, I mean, you know, the focus is on it,
exactly.
Obviously. Yeah. In terms of finances, so that's the major point of mine. In terms of finances, yes, I was happy to see China mentioned. 1.2 billion loan, you know, to build transmission lines with Addis, first of all, and then that was in 2013, later in 2017, China becoming as a savior, of course, again, you know, for Egypt, for Ethiopia to further finance certain issues. But, you know, there is a looming debt distress,
exactly.
Over Ethiopia, as we know. Far too much dependence on Chinese loans at the moment. Sri Lankan example, and many other examples all across, yeah? So, you know, finances-wise, China has become one of the key players, and if we look into the Sudanese realm, from a geopolitical perspective, in terms of South Sudanese civil war undergoing, you know, or ongoing, basically, plus the Chinese in Sudan, you know, with all the oil-related infrastructure developments, that makes it even more peculiar, I think, in the whole wide Horn of Africa region. And
definitely.
The final point is exactly connected to South Sudan. Because, yes, I mean, climate change would cause a lot of problems, as we saw, especially the Delta region and so on.
Yes.
But, you know, man-made diseases of this kind.
Of course.
Such as a civil war in the northern Tigray region, as well as in South Sudan, right after the secession took place. Make it even worse. So all in all, concluding, you know, this is a very big, long-lasting geopolitical turmoil which cannot be solved, as far as I'm concerned, in the coming years. Not at all. Yes, I agree with you. More negotiations, you know, in the Nile Basin Initiative. That must be the way forward. What is the real scenario? You know?
Yeah, I mean, thank you very much, Professor. So, I really believe that these countries should try to solve their problems themselves, and not depend on international institutions. As we have seen, and as you yourself have pointed to, that China invested a lot of money in this Ethiopian project and in other Ethiopian projects as well. So China is trying to implement in Ethiopia what it did in Pakistan and in the Central Asian countries. This is one of the China's worldwide plans. So Ethiopia here becomes part of this plan. On the other hand, what really stuns me and really it astonishes me is that the current American administration is just doesn't care about this whole problem. And they just left it. They just turned their back to this problem. The Biden administration, of course, I understand their issue in Afghanistan and withdrawing from Afghanistan. And now their focus is on fixing the mess they did in Afghanistan. But with this withdrawal, but they shouldn't turn their back to this problem. So the final step was when the Trump administration offered this $5 billion development fund to Ethiopia. This came, in fact, as a response for the Chinese fund and the Chinese investment there. So the United States under the Trump administration, the previous administration, tried to keep up the pace with China in the region. So they backed up Egypt for a long time, but once they saw and they found that Ethiopia didn't sign this draft last year in Washington. So what the United States did is to play the game with China. So that's why they offered this fund. If Ethiopia gives concessions, if Ethiopia agrees, this was just, if you agree with Egypt, we'll give you $5 billion. This didn't happen because Ethiopia didn't agree. Why? Because Ethiopia doesn't need the United States. Ethiopia is playing with everyone. Ethiopia is playing a really big regional game. So this is why it's a really geopolitical game in the region. It involves everyone. Egypt, Israel, we didn't talk about this, the Gulf countries. The Gulf countries themselves also have investments in this project and in future Ethiopian projects. So it is very complicated. But I hope that this scenario does not lead to war at the end, because war will be the worst case.
War would be not a regional war only. It may be the next, if in that, you know, we take that path, the next world war of Africa, you know?
Maybe.
So,
yes,
you know,
yes.
It's even more dangerous, I would say.
Even very dangerous. And the displacement of a lot of communities and people. So, and the livelihoods of millions, of tens of millions of people will be in danger, will be threatened. And I think that if the war happens, it might not take the shape of a straight war between two nations. It will be a proxy war. And this is, to a certain extent, is going on now. So with the Tigrinian conflict, and I don't know, and there is no evidence of Egypt's involvement in any of the turmoil taking place in Ethiopia. And I don't believe that Egypt is doing that. But still, what is really a big problem is the Tigrinian conflict in Ethiopia. And there has been a very dangerous thing, or it was a threat, direct threat to the dam in the last 2 weeks. So now the Ethiopian Ministry of Defense, the Ethiopian MOD, deployed special forces to the dam region because they are afraid of attacks from the Tigrinian rebels on the dam. So the internal situation in Ethiopia is very unrestful and internal, and I think that ethnic problems will keep on rising between this very diverse community in Ethiopia. And if the economical issue is not fixed and the infrastructure is not put in context, so not improving the infrastructure will cause civil wars in Ethiopia. So that's why Ethiopia needs this project and needs the future projects to stay one country. And on the other hand, Egypt needs the water. So this is an unsolvable case. I agree with Professor Taroshi that this will not be solved in the forthcoming years. This will always be a problem because something has changed forever. So what that thing is the accessibility to the water of the Nile. So who is utilizing the Nile? There has been a historical vision of this, that, okay, Egypt and Sudan utilize the Nile. Okay, thank you very much. Ethiopia has other resources. So, but now, this changed. This changed forever. So what other solutions? We just saw a couple of opportunities for Egypt to solve its problems. But as we see, Egypt is incapable internally to solve this problem. So everyone can imagine, I don't know where will the political efforts lead, but I think that the best place to be solved is the NBI. Yeah. And let's hope the best. Yes. Thank you very much.
Yeah, I would like to ask, what do you think? Is it possible to be internal solution or part of a solution to reduce or control overpopulation for a long-term solution, I mean?
In Egypt,
inside
you mean?
Egypt, yes.
Yes, in Egypt.
Or is does Egypt have capacity to arrange this?
Well, thank you. This is a very good question. And in fact, the Egyptian government has been doing that for years now. Now, there are a lot of initiatives conducted by the government. For example, the program, which is called Itnin Kifaya, Two Are Enough, introduced by President Abdel Fattah Sisi in 2015, I think. Maybe I'm wrong, 2014, but that's the beginning of his... Yes, Itnin Kifaya. So this was a program initiated by the Sisi government. So what's the extent of its effect? Not that much, because you have to change, in fact, the cultural and background, the habit, and Islam. So that's, yes, Islam, because they say that every child brings wealth with it. So the growth of families, there is an attitude in the old Islamic communities, especially the rural communities, which said that the more children, the restful old life for the father. So if we have more children, then you will have a restful retirement years. So they will have, every child is a work labor, so is a labor. So this changed for the reasons I mentioned. So Egypt has to adapt. So is it possible to reduce the population? Apart from such programs and the government enhancing and giving concessions and trying to convince the people not to make more children, so this is a very long term issue, and it needs a cultural shift.
Thank you.
Thank you for the question. Okay, so if there are no more questions, really thank you very much for coming here today. I hope the lecture wasn't too long. I hope you benefited from it as much as possible. I tried to wrap up everything in 1 hour. I did it in almost 2 hours, but I think for myself, this is still a good achievement. So thank you very much. Thank you. So knowing myself, this is really good. To do it in 2 hours, so thank you a lot.